represent for. This is stuff that I think that gives us pride and we take pride in. you know, it's really a shame. You kind of fall the victim, you know, at least with a lot of resistance. That's what I've been trying to do.
Part of my life incarcerated in federal prison. I finished a 18-year sentence for bank robbery and weapon charges in 2009. By the time I was incarcerated, I was blessed to under the mentorship of Captain Social Corps, who was Tupac's father. I think my father's really appreciate the influence he had on his politics and career. And for about 12 years, we worked together throughout three federal institutions, and we did a lot of what we like to call social work inside of the jail. Because we realized that in order for us to change and come back to the community, we had to change our personalities, check our characters, realize who we really are or who we aspire to be. Because many times you think that you are taking care of your family, you think you are a certain kind of person, but you're convicted and you go to prison for a major part of your life, leave all those who say love. So the love that you are professing for your family maybe isn't real. But we have to examine your entire worldview. So we did that. We educated each other. When Congress cut off the Pell Grants and we don't go to college in 1996, we formed an association with Georgia University. They trained professors, activists, students, and former classes, and with that, one thing I'll say about Joseph Corey is he will probably never go home because he's accused by the government of masterminding the plot to steal Asashiko from New Jersey prison, in Cuba, where she is, so he's dead. But what he has done is, since he can't go home, he sent hundreds or literally, I think, thousands of men back into the community to do the work that we do there. So when I came home, I continued to do what I was doing inside. I earned my social degree while I was inside, and then I became a bachelor's degree from the University of Phoenix, and I'm involved in the master's degree program. We believe that education is the key to us changing our lives. And I started the Center for Returning Citizens, which is a nonprofit organization that assists all those who are coming home from prison in their transition. Even though I had planned for many years, my return to society was extremely rough. When I came out in 2009, it was a bad economy, it was hard to find a job, it was hard to reconnect with my family to the same level that I thought I should have, you know. Rocky transition, if it was this difficult for me, and I'm fairly well educated, articulate, and I have a plan for the future, how much more difficult is it for guys who have no idea what they're suffering? So we started TCRC, and the first thing we did was help guys find jobs, because unless you have a job, you can't function. And then we have counseling sessions, we do case management, we try to connect them with any services in the city which would enable them to move forward. And we're trying to form a peer support network, kind of similar to 12-step and put out the bullshit. We call it reality-based. We talk about real things, you know, coming home and trying to do the right thing, you know, if your baby mama wants you to, you know, make a bad idea before, your kids want new sneakers, and all of a sudden daddy's home, and they expect another world. But you can't give the world anymore because you're fine trying to do the right thing. You're only making $10 an hour, and you can't always get over something but yourself. You know? And your boys are like, look, man, you know, just come here to the package, man, you can do what you did. You know, but a lot of guys are sincerely ready to change your lives, but it's very, very difficult. So we offer an environment where they can come, where they can laugh, where they can say anything, and they can get help. One of our benefactors, we just acquired a storefront at 3850 Germantown Avenue, and it's all finished now. We're listening to contributions. We've been getting more tables, chairs, bathroom computers, and we're going to set up shop there. We're also in Center City at the Friends Center, But we needed a place in the community that's more accessible. You know, so our plan is to slowly over time to locate TCRC centers and communities all over the city. So guys can come and get help, and there'll be somewhere where they can feel at home and get assistance in moving forward. So when I was out for a while, I connected with Incarcerate, and they were like-minded people. They realized the extent of mass incarceration. 2 weeks ago, we went to Harrisburg, we walked 150 miles to Harrisburg, and that was crazy. It was totally exhilarating, liberating. It's hard to find adjectives to describe the experience, because the maximum walk was like 20 miles in a day. We averaged between like maybe 14 or 16 miles a day. Churches opened the doors to us. We spread our sleeping bags at night, they fed us. We interacted with various communities all the way through. We marched from like Philly to Haverford, Haverford to Norristown, Norristown to Pottstown, Pottstown to Reading, Reading to Wilmsworth, Wilmsworth to Hershey, and Hershey to Harrisburg. It was outstanding. You can go on the incarceration website and kind of look at the progression. That's kind of how I got involved in mass incarceration, because I've been mass incarcerated.
And I'll say a couple things about my involvement. I've been an activist for like 10 or 11 years and got really involved when I was living in Cincinnati, Ohio. And it was just after the rebellion there against racism and police brutality, so I did a lot of organizing against racism and police brutality in Cincinnati. I'm originally from Germantown, just north of Philly, so I came back here to this area and continued doing activist work, and that led me to law school. I wanted to, you know, see if I could use law as a way for, you know, another piece to make social change. And in law school, I really gravitated towards prisoners' rights and civil rights. And in my third year, actually it's my second summer, so right before my third year, I was working for the big civil rights law firm in town, Carries Rudowski, Messing and Kleinberg, who was suing the Philadelphia prison system for severe overcrowding and unconstitutional conditions. And so I got to go in and interview some of the prisoners in that lawsuit. And here's Gene Law, Mike Law, and Kim. You want to join us? So, welcome. Both these guys have presented with me. This would be, and I'll ask them to introduce themselves in a second. So, I also had a filmmaking background, and I saw the need for public education around this issue. People don't quite understand the whole, you know, history of the problem and the extent of the problem, and I think what's needed to change it. So I made the movie with that in mind, and I've been working full-time over the last year touring the movie and sort of doing national organizing and national consciousness raising, because I feel like before we're going to see a mass movement, which is what I think is necessary to change the system, people need to become aware and sort of study what is actually the workings of the system and the history of it. So that's what I've been doing, is I've been touring this movie around and trying to, wherever I go, present panel discussions like this of people who have been in the system, people who are advocating for systemic change, then also make connections, create safe spaces for people who were formerly incarcerated, because I think there is a lot of stigma. It's this weird thing, and I'd love for you to talk more about it, where the media and the culture sort of likes to portray that it's a thing you should be proud of, but it seems that also within the community there is also, on the other side of that, stigma, and families often don't want to talk about people who are incarcerated or even people having been incarcerated themselves. And I think we need to be talking about it if we're going to get more people involved and make some change. So with that, let me hand it over to Michael G. Law, and why don't you introduce yourself and explain some of the work that you've been doing.
Okay. How do you look today?
Good.
My name is Michael Oji Altaban. I am the Chief Executive Servant of God's Love and Work Foundation and Jamal Al-Tan Corp, which is a non-profit and for-profit say unit, for the lack of a better word, that works together in a prison to premature death prevention. This subject encompasses many things, kind of name from the recidivism, we call it revisitism, to eating wrong, prison and premature death. There's a wide range of things that we need to deal with, but because we understand that it's a complex problem, everybody thinks they have the answer, and what they don't realize is everybody has a piece of the answer. And if we begin to work together and the five fingers ball them to a fist, only then can we begin to truly fight. When it is welcome, I also bring a spiritual aspect to this problem, because if you have had enough catastrophe in your life to have been introduced to the Most High, then you understand that we are definitely at war, and the war is called Armageddon, and the battlefield is
coming in
mind. And the Bible says to be not conformed to this world, be transformed by the renewing of your mind, so us spreading this information. The Bible says my people will suffer because of lack of knowledge. We all suffering together now. Black, white, put on the color that seems to matter, that most people have is green. So now everybody's getting a taste of what it's like to be a slave. The police are no longer police, they're correctional officers. And your homes have become your prison. So we all need to be free from the chains. If you doubt it, you don't feel safe going to certain places in your free country. If your country is so free, why can't you go any place you want to go? You can have your ID on you in your pocket and the police roll up around the corner and you can show them your ID and they still tell you to take it in your house. Get off the corner. Bye. Go in. That's the new game. We all locked down in America right now. So it's time for the people who understand that to really stand up and begin not only to be camp, just free your body. A person who's just locked up in chains is a prisoner. A slave is somebody that's locked up in their mind. And this is where we have to fight this war in the minds of the people.
Well, I'm going to talk and everything to sort of open up for discussion.
My name is Tak. I work with a youth-led organization called YES, Youth Art and Self-Empowerment Project. Meg is a good friend of mine. J-Law, this woman, Mr. John Dye, that's a very good friend of mine also. And I guess today we're just like really talking about mass incarceration. But YES is also a coalition with Incarcerate PA. Incarcerate PA is basically like no new prisons. Reinvestment
in
incarcerated set the people free, basically. I'm
gonna pass
it on now. I don't really
get
too much to say.
What do you
want to
talk about?
What
you asked? Can you tell us what you asked
us? We go into the jails every Saturday and we workshops with juveniles held in the state where we had a petition to repeal 833. And 833 was a law that was passed in 1996 that allowed juveniles under the age of 18 to be held in trial, charges, and held in the adult facility.
Tell them about Kelly.
We did a workshop with John B. Kelly, that's elementary school. We did it with the fifth graders, and we talked to them about how they take away from like extra curriculums in school. They're closed in 24 schools, and how much they're taking away from the schools for the money, and they're like building more prisons. And like the kids are so disappointed, so we did activities about it, and we asked them, what is the school to prison pipeline? The school to prison pipeline is basically like when the school does this thing where it pushes you out and it leads you to somewhere you don't want to be, which is prison. So we asked them to break that pipeline, and we asked them what was goals. And some of the young kids, they came up with some pretty bright ideas, like school to career, or school to job, or school to college. And it was like, they didn't know who was going, so we informed them. The parts were really broken, but we kind of shared them up. I think I'm kind of famous in this school.
Yeah.
said that juveniles can be incarcerated and held there, as adults.
This is 833.
833. And petition it to have that removed.
Yes.
I think obviously that's a terrible look, you know? And obviously everything you look at is very terrible, you know what I mean? I think it's kind of bizarre to try to appeal to the system, you know? I'll pick up on what you said, because you were talking about a police can come up, you know, a policeman can come up to you and harass you, basically. You know, you feel you're subject to his law. I think that's the problem, you know what I'm saying? Like I said, I love that you brought a spiritual element to it, because, you know, if we look at it, this is modern day slavery is what it is, you know what I'm saying? So if we take it to slavery, you know, slavery has manifested itself in our history in all types of different ways, you know, so that manifests itself this way, but let's put our mindset into an earlier manifestation, you know, perhaps in the United States, early 1800s, 1700s, you know, perhaps when slaves were being taken out of Africa and brought to North America for the first time, you know? I mean, it would have been pretty bizarre to ask the people to start petitions to be like, you shouldn't be doing this, you know, even to go to law school, you know? I mean, I think it would have been pretty bizarre to do anything except be like, no, you know? You know what I mean? I know that sounds crazy. People think that's crazy. It doesn't make any sense. We're dealing with a system that it's on purpose the way it is. You know what I mean? Nobody is trying to do a good job and just doing so poorly that we need to correct them. They're trying to do a bad job and they're doing a great job. They're trying to do a bad thing and they're doing a great job. I think we lie to ourselves and we're like, you know, the system is broken. The system is not broken. The system is working like a charm. You know what I'm saying? So when we stop that, I think it gives us the wrong thing. Spirituality, I think, is what is going to give people the courage and the commitment to being like, I don't know what's gonna happen, but I know what's not gonna happen. I know that I'm not gonna be enslaved. You know what I mean? I know that I'm not gonna go to prison. You know? I know that I'm gonna stand up for myself. What's gonna happen? You know, people will have to probably take severe beatings, administer severe beatings, and I'm not in. We can spend this whole panel. We can spend this whole panel talking about things like petitions and legal ways. This is not our system. It's not for us. They come at us with ferocity and with aggression and violent force. You know, and I'm not talking about violence. There's many different ways, and everybody has. I believe that everyone on this panel and everybody here, you know, is here to serve purposes and different roles, and it sounds like all the work that everybody's doing sounds amazing and phenomenal, you know? But we have to be willing to die for this. This is a big deal, and we have to be willing to die for this. We, all of us in this room, I feel, have to be like, we're not gonna allow ourselves to be arrested. We don't go for that arresting thing. We feel like it's about protecting society. We feel like it's about a slave society, so we're not going for it anymore. We're not getting arrested anymore. I think we should start with not getting arrested anymore. I'm sorry, we're not getting arrested anymore. I'm gonna be arrested. I think this is a big deal. I haven't heard a lot of people talking about this. If I go outside and they go to arrest me, I'm not gonna get arrested. Who knows what's gonna happen? I'm not gonna get arrested though, because I don't go for that. You know what I mean? And I think if more people didn't go for that, and if all of us didn't go for that and went to convince people are gonna be scared. You know what I mean? People are gonna be scared. But what takes fear away is obviously spirituality. For me, that's what it does. Not even takes it away, but allows you to move forward even when you're scared. You know what I mean? This is what I'm supposed to do. I'm supposed to stand up for myself, and I'm not here to live like I'm, scared, you know? So I just want to introduce that earlier before we started talking about appealing to the people that want to hurt us, you know, because that's all they want to do, you know?
I never been incarcerated. One of our principal cases is abolishing the system. Now, when we say abolishing the system, some people think that we are talking violence, we're talking forces. But when you think about how the system is structured, from the time you have a stop on the street where they arrest you, to when you go to the prosecutor, to the judge, or you get to the system, it's all designed to enslave people of color. That's a given. So you have to start with the basic premise. Who are they arresting? Why are they targeting these people? Why would it get to the prosecutor's office? People of color are the predominant persons who look at the entire process. They get very little probation, they get very little breaks. And then who's profiting on the other man? Yes, the system as it stands right now is almost impossible because it's making there's so much money. But it takes small groups like this, and then people being more conscious and questioning why is the system structured like this before we can attack it. You have to have the support of the community before you get involved in the system. That's what we're doing now. That's what we did with the march to Harrisburg. But it wasn't just a march to Harrisburg for symbolic terms. What we're doing was connecting with people. We were identifying people in the community who was of like mind. And we plan to go back to those communities, organize, start incarcerated chapters, and continue to move forward. Don't think that we'll come around with a film or a presentation, just a one-time thing. We're just trying to make people sympathetic. We're trying to start a movement to abolish the prison system in this country as we know. First in Pennsylvania, and then all over the country.
Yeah, I'll say something, and then I think you have something to say, and then maybe we can get some reactions from you all. I agree with a lot of what you have to say, and I am a prison abolitionist, and I think we as human beings have, you know, the prison system is a relatively new phenomenon. It's something we built up, it's something we can also destroy. I think it's so tied to capitalism and the capitalist system in this country that in order to address it, in order to end mass incarceration, and you really are going to do it, you need to talk about restructuring society and the profit motive that keeps this, you know, teeny 0.001% benefiting from the rest of us fighting or being imprisoned or, you know, not getting what we really deserve and building up the wealth, you know, we all built up. But how do you get there? If you're talking about revolutionizing a system, you need a lot of people on board with that, right? And if you're, because, you know, in this country, I think you're not going to do a violent revolution because we have the strongest military police forces on earth. I think it has to be masses of people refusing to be arrested, refusing to do this, refusing to do that. And we need to convince everyone that this is the way to go and that we would all benefit from this. So with having that long-term goal in mind, how do we organize people? How do you work with people to get them on your side? And I do think that organizing certain reforms along the way that can actually benefit people, like ending the death penalty, for example, that doesn't end the system, but I think it would benefit some people. Ending life without parole, ending treating juveniles as adults in the system. Those are things we can organize for that are not going to end mass incarceration, but what you do is you show people that when you organize, you can fight and win something. And along the way, you understand that in order to organize and win, we need to work white, black, brown together. You know, we need to work together to be able to defeat police brutality, these different things. And you talk with them about politics along the way. You talk about what is the long-term vision? What are we going for? Are we just going for the end of prisons? Do we still want, you know, massive ghettos in our cities where people have no opportunity except for drugs, you know, alcohol, or the church? Like, do we want more than that? You know? So I think it's a little bit about sort of how do you get to that long-term vision. And so I'll give you that. Go ahead.
First thing I just wanted to address was to support a statement about how the system isn't broken, but it's working perfectly. I had the opportunity to march from a place to another place on the map in Washington City. Not many people get to do that. Mm. And in walking from place to place, the places where we had support, and we definitely had word that the governor was actually moving against us, not just talking about it. He was putting people out with flyers against us. He was actually moving against us. a bunch of kids that just want an educational system over a prison system, and we're moving against it. And it was funny because the people who supported us the most was the people who built the first penitentiary in Pennsylvania and North Carolina, the Quakers. The Quakers have realized that they created a monstrosity, and though won't stand in the forefront of the movement to tear it down, but will support the people who have a direct David and Goliath-like mission. This proves that the system indeed is working perfectly the way the people who have it now, because the people who originated it, when it was supposed to only be one man in the cell so he could be penitent. You see, those people want to tear it down, and they built it. So they know that their creation is nothing worse than an artist to see his artwork being used outside of its proper context. That's like me making a song telling my wife I love you and they turn me into some kind of porn king. You just, it just tarnishes the entire movement. So they're so ashamed of it that they're willing to support the people who want to tear it down. They actually have faith in us. Another thing is abolish the system, impeachment. I wanted to mention about abolishing the system based upon the Constitution of the United States of America. I think that we got so caught up with the sideshow spectacles and the catastrophe that they create in order to distract us from what's really going on, that we don't realize what the original document of this country says by the founding fathers who built this country based upon rebellion from England. They said that this country is based by a principle that we are a government by the people, of the people, and for the people. And I don't know the exact language, but I know it's something violent in there. It said, if this was Grandpa Mom said, if they stop being that way, then we supposed to take it back. This is why you have the right to bear arms. It's a free country, so you're supposed to protect yourself. It's a free country, so the Chinese store ain't supposed to close at 11 o'clock. The rules that are placed in society are for the masses, not for the individuals, but they actually cater to drug dealers and rich people. You look at the car, PPA, they got on there parking wars. It's a TV show where they clown us in Philadelphia, the birthplace of America, for taking our transportation. It should be called parking bullies, because I've never seen nobody fighting back for their car. And what happens to the car is they're recycled through the ghetto neighborhoods of Philadelphia and the surrounding counties. Watch how it works. They take your car, they take it to the auction when you can't pay, they sell it to the drug dealers and to the rich people who got the money to buy cars and gold. They wait till your tax returns come back, all the poor people gonna buy a car doing tax returns. They sell you the same cars back within 6 months because you really can't afford to drive. You can't afford to pay a ticket. They're gonna take your car again. You're gonna wait for tax returns. You're gonna recycle the cars from the same drug dealers and car people. They're doing it to us year after year after year because we are in prison. And that is our commissary, and they control everything we eat, everything we see, everything we listen to, every car we drive. If I was you, I would drive old cars that don't have the system that's connected to the satellite, so at least you can have some privacy. Because when they allowed the catastrophe of 9/11 to take place, the new Constitution of the United States of America became the so-called Patriot Act. This is what we operating under. This is why they don't have no privacy anymore. This is what we gave away when we allowed them to terrorize us. When George Bush stood up in the church and said, I hope God forgives you because we sure won't. The fight is not against flesh and blood. but against principalities, against powers, against rulers of darkness, and spiritual wickedness in high places. The highest place on your body is your mind. This is what we battle, and this is the Armageddon that we talk about. You're talking to a brother who understands how Jackson versus Hendrix got in place in prison. You can't do it by yourself. If you go out there and you refuse to get locked up by yourself, half the people you're sitting in this room with is going to stand around and watch you get locked up by yourself. It's just the truth. So hear me. I'm not saying it cannot be organized, but what I'm saying is, certain conversations is so premature that you put yourself in danger when you open your fucking mouth like that.
Which was being named already.
I'm not checking.
No, I hear you.
No disrespect. But when you're talking war talk around people who you trying to just get them to even understand, this ain't the time when every one of these people gonna go in the back after you talk and get a pitchfork and stick like they used to. It's not, you see what I'm trying to say to you? So I'm not down in what you're saying, but as a war specialist, you gotta know when to throw the punch. If you do the right thing at the wrong time, you won't get the right results. I.e., if I throw a punch at you right there, I miss you. It's the wrong time. I need to wait till I get over there to throw the punch. We ain't ready yet.
Have I been
boot camp.
One thought.
Mental boot camp.
Like, to my guys, right, who I'm trying to integrate back to society, what just ended up not being arrested again is a brilliant concept. It's community one.
Indeed.
But for my guys who are already vulnerable and who are trying to rebuild their lives, if they refuse to get arrested, they're endangering their entire future. So sometimes you have to be strategic in your planning and your implementation of long-term strategy.
I don't disagree with you, and I don't disagree with you either. But if I may, we are already in danger. And we already, our futures are already in jeopardy. I don't know when the time is, but if the time ain't yet, then I'm not willing to wait for when the time is. I'm not concerned. You're talking about things that we can do on the way to get it in the grand scheme. All I know is, 100%, I guarantee you that we could shut down the prison industrial system if people refuse to go to jail. I guarantee it. 100%. 100% guaranteed rape. We don't need no petitions. We don't need no lawyers. We don't need to rally.
So the question is, how do you do that?
Well, I know how I do it. And I'm telling other people that they can do it. And I'm telling other people that that's what we have to do. This is what we have to do. And I'm not even, I have complete respect for Dr. Martin Luther King, Mahatma Gandhi, people that I think it takes a lot of courage and a lot of conviction to be nonviolent. And I think that that is a fantastic strategy, But I'm way more concerned with what's not gonna happen. I'm not gonna get arrested. I don't know what is gonna happen, but I wanna shut this thing down. And I'm tired of waiting. I believe the time to throw the punch has come and gone, you know what I mean? I believe that we are now, in overtime or something, bonus rounds or something like that. Who knows if we've gone too far? Who knows if there's a possibility to win the fight anymore, But I'm tired of it, and this is 100%. This is 100%. You wanna, I'm all about organization, and I'm not about trying to, I wanna be smart, I wanna live, I don't wanna die, Organized, plan, be strategic to the best of our abilities, to be strategic, to be mindful, to be calm, to be composed, to the best of our capabilities, but we have to draw a line. This problem is because they lock us up. Our line comes with going to lock us up. We'll talk with you, we'll build with you, we'll organize, but the locking us up part, that doesn't happen anymore. And
wouldn't that increase the prison system if you refuse to get locked up? Because they're going to send more police. And eventually, you're going to go.
They're not locking me up. In fact, they're not locking me up. And look.
How would you stop them from locking you up?
I would not get locked up. There's a much higher. I'll be dead before I get locked up. And being dead is, I'm not trying to be dead. And I'm not trying to make it sound like, I'm not, this isn't a.
So you're advocating martyrdom?
I'm not advocating martyrdom. I'm advocating standing up for yourself. We look at what? We look at, you know, people talk about the Native Americans and they talk about how they refuse to be enslaved, you know? I think that's honorable. People watch movies like 300. Oh, we about to go die. You know, these other pictures and all that. I've never been in prison myself. I'm never going to prison. And you know, I got all types of brothers and sisters that have been in prison, and I speak with them all the time. I mean no disrespect. And I made all types of mistakes in my life. You know what I mean? And I've been lucky. God has blessed me. There's all types of times in my life that I might have wound up in prison and was lucky not to. But I feel like once I have a conversation with somebody, and if we come to agree that there is an element, you know, dare I say, because it's such a touchy subject, dare I say that there is an element of cowardice to enslavement? I think I dare say it, given knowledge and understanding. As I, after discussion, if I'm able to meet with somebody and talk with them, we can come to an agreement that it's more important to stand up for yourself alive than to not stand up for yourself alive, be dead, not, you know, be dead for standing up for yourself. I do believe that there's an element of cowardice to enslavement, you know? And then I'm not, you know, I know you did, I'm not calling you a coward at all, but anything like that. And I would never do that, you know? But I'm just saying, talking is not working. We have to draw the line. We will die for it. That's how things get done. I'm not, you know, martyrdom, is that what it's called when people die for what they believe in? Then I am advocating that. You know, I hope it doesn't come. I don't want to come to that. I got family, you know what I'm saying?
Let me just give it to Todd and then get some questions and then we'll come back to the rest of us.
I just want to touch on when he said standing up for yourself. I mean, if you stand up, it's fighting back. That's what you're doing, basically. Like, it's mass incarceration. Don't nobody want to be taken away from their basic needs. That's structural violence. Don't nobody want to do that. Don't nobody want to be in a jail cell looking at walls. Four blocks, they're white. What are we thinking about? What are we planning for? We need to get the word out. We need to reinvest into our communities. We need them to know that the youth is at risk too. It's not just the adults. Because if you get an adult arrest record, that's like you cannot get a job, a good paying job. Like I couldn't, I had to go to an organization. And now that's why I'm here. I'm only 17. I got a 1-year-old son, and I want him to be successful in life. I don't want him to be without. I had it. Y'all had it. The cops even had it. Because how did they get their badge? They had to go to school, right? School is important. We need to end mass incarceration. We need to talk, get together, organize. We need to be a family. We need to organize this. We need to fight for what we know. Because if you don't fight, you will fall for anything.
Jill and then Erica.
So my question is, you refuse to be arrested. So what does that mean? Does that mean that you follow the straight and narrow, that you don't get yourself in trouble? Like, I'm not exactly sure what that means.
In New York City, they have stop. I'm from New York City. Mm-hmm. They have stop and frisk. Mm-hmm. And I'm going to say that it's 1900. Stop and frisk that day, right? I've never stopped and frisk. And I'll never be stopped and frisk because one of my lines is people putting their hands on me without my permission, and I feel that's an important line as a human being in a free country, you know? What's gonna happen? I don't know what's gonna happen. I've been approached by police.
I can tell you what happened.
Well, listen, I mean, you can tell me what might happen. I might get beat down, right?
I'll tell you what will happen in the Philadelphia Police Department. Trust them.
I prefer. Yeah. I would prefer that. Wouldn't I prefer that than having somebody tell me when they open my hands on me? Like, you talk about bullies, you know, you're 17, I'm 32, but I remember when I was a young person, and I remember bullies, we learn about bullies as young children, because we have to learn how to deal with bullies. You know, now I know the new craze is like trying to get rid of bullying, but when I was a kid, it was bullies, and you had to fight bullies. You might take, but bullies are not bullying the kid that fights back. You know what I mean? Everybody's not big and strong. The difference is some people stand up for themselves. You know what I mean? That's why bullies stop bullying me. That's why. Bullies don't stop bullying people from what I prefer, what I much prefer, making a scene out there for the most slightest thing. I'm gonna arrest you for jaywalking. You can't arrest me for jaywalking. I don't care if you're gonna let me out now. What I much prefer, psycho lunatic gets beat to death on the street instead of going to jail. I much prefer that than having somebody in my mom like that, ain't me.
Let me tell you what I prefer. What we try to structure in TCRC, we got a philosophy. We're never going back to jail. Now we're saying the same thing you're saying, but we're structuring it in a different way. We're trying to structure our lives so we are never going back to jail. So we are citizens. When I drive down the street, my license is correct, my registration is correct, my insurance is correct. But the police pulls me over, he has no logical reason to, one, put his hands on me, two, lock me up. All the things that we are doing in the community make us respected. People in the neighborhood know us. And police come around to arrest us, everybody in the block says, no, these are the guys who are out here teaching our kids. They're the ones who are trying to make a change in the community. So when you say they'll be arrested, and you're speaking in that context, I'm totally with you. Because when you make a life change and a community change, then instead of being we say it like this. In our former lives, we were a destructive part of society. We robbed banks, we sold drugs, we did many things that destroyed the community. And we were known for that. Everybody really knew that. We came out and we're trying to rebuild the community and we've changed our lives. So there's no reason to incarcerate us. And we are a now beneficial part of the community. Now the police is going to come to us and say, listen, you know, we see what you're doing, you know, can we assist you? I mean, there's a different vibration. So if you create that vibration and that strength, then you won't have that conflict you're talking about. And not only do that, you can influence young people in the community. So many of our guys, the kids call them OGs, original gangsters. And that's what they were. And the kids respect that because they see it on BET, they see it on TV and the media. What you say about the media creating that image our young feeds into is correct. But by the same token, since they have that perception, when they see guys who have lived that life for real, not BET bullshit, really live that, and they come on and they say, listen, that ain't the life. You ain't trying to spend 25 years in a dorm. Come to our community center, come to our job program, come work with us. This is what is beneficial to our communities.
Can I say something on the topic real quick?
Yeah.
I got a community center and 11 referral officers assisted by police right in my center. It's not the case. I've been doing this since 2005. I put that rest in peace wall up there with everybody's name and age that got killed in 2006. It became like a monument center. And I've been doing this work every day. Ceasefire program, and everywhere I went, because I wasn't the conflict that I had, union presidents and people who were for the police sending me drug dealers to try to get money for their campaign when he was running for office. I see it on tape, it's not even power. And it's still in. Everybody ain't ready for what you're talking about, but I'm a soldier. I walked away from the money, I walked away from the demo plan, it's crack dealers. Running to the programs of the city that's supposed to be out here to help people. And I know for a fact, we talk about poverty, pain, we talk about going to war. What you gotta do, man, is understand, first of all, when you do good, the evil forces is gonna move against you. Jesus said, do not think that I've come to a world to bring peace, for I've come to bring a sword. I've come to put mother against father, sister against brother, yet a man's enemies against his own household. He said, you will be persecuted for righteousness' sake. There's never been a change when people who try to bring their body suffer for the change. How bad you want it? You gotta go through to get to it. This is how this country was built. Listen, we all here for a reason because we care, and there are tactics that we can utilize to win. For instance, you can take a pay last year when you were in prison, because the reason why you can get toilet paper when you go to prison is because of Jackson versus Hendricks. The reason why you can get haircuts and all that while you go to court. But Jackson wanted to buy something. He had a whole team of jailhouse lawyers pushing him. It was a collective. The Camp Hill riots that changed a lot of things for a lot of people that some people still in the hole for right now. They still sitting there. Some of the people wasn't even fighting in the riot. They just was at the wrong place at the wrong time. But they didn't tell. But the people who come in and get televisions and recreation and things that they just don't understand what the people before them had to go through. And right now it's not popular to be a stand-up guy. And what I'm trying to tell you is, I've been the crash dummy that was standing up all by itself. I slept outside Hurricane Sandy chained to Love Park. I'll ask every preacher, son of God, Muslim, anybody who loved God and understood it. God's love, and this is Love Park, but this park is owned by God. First of all, they got to stop chasing the kids, and this is where we're going to begin. Nobody came. I was jogging around the pool 7 times by myself praying for the city in a hurricane. But I also got to see that vengeance is mine, saith the Lord. Bro, when I seen that storm coming and trees bending, Michael Nutter ran in that fucking house. And all his officers was gone. So I'm telling you, it's a different way of war. There is a time for what you're talking about. But if you move ahead, it becomes insubordination. If you want to win, and you don't just want to be heard, it's like a father whose daughter that got raped. His personal revenge is so strong, I gotta go out there and kill him, beat the dude who did it, and I don't care if I go to jail, because this is for my family. And then he goes to jail. And then his daughter get out of the hospital. And then the other demon. Because you don't kill the demons when you beat the body, because the body is flesh and blood, and God said the war ain't against that. So when the freaky demon jump into the other war, and he go grab the daughter, and he do it to the daughter again, guess where daddy at? My daughter need help. He in prison sitting there because he couldn't wait. I need my revenge now. I'm not willing to wait no more. It became a selfish thing. And so then his daughter got raped again. So the people who have this type of power and energy is supposed to be servants to the people who can. So don't move ahead based upon a feeling and emotion. Oh, nobody disagreed with you. They said, let us strategize. Let us reason together so that we can accomplish what we set up. Do you want to be heard or do you want results?
I would love results.
I'm sorry if I'm taking too long.
No, I would love results.
But I don't want to see the man get himself hurt. And I know that, listen, there was a man named Daniil Gidding that said, when I got out of jail, I ain't never going back to jail again. He was walking down the street, the police was chasing somebody else, but they was running behind him to get to them. He turned around, put a 4-pound out, and shot the cop in the face. 2 cops ran behind him, shot him all on his back. He set up with the whole court in the street, but it wasn't even for him. When he did that though, let me tell you what happened. I was out there doing the rest in peace walk. They snatched me off the street along with 50,000 other people based upon Dr. Kemp's memorandum. You can't imagine what Greater Fool was like when the people was in the hole who was in the solid court after 15 years getting ready to go home off of one loose cannon that just couldn't wait. So many soldiers that was going to come out and do the right thing got held up because one soldier, I'm done. Hold your fire! Hold your fire! Bop! Boom, 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 it's a shootout. Because one guy couldn't hold the fire and you lose. Even though your intentions is pure.
Let me, I just want to not get bogged down totally in this conversation, so let me open it up for some other thoughts. Erica, I think you had a question.
I'm in situations. One thing, you know, I don't spend a lot of money on much of anything, and I don't watch the news, what paid money for cable or any of this, but one thing I did spend money on is concerts, so when I read Homeboy's article and I did my own research, it was an easy decision for me to say, okay, I wouldn't spend my money on these artists anymore. I think that's one simple solution. I think we're dealing with a very, very racist system. I think it is a fight. I wouldn't call it anything else. My concerns for, or what made this a, my one of my biggest concerns, and what I think are most, the biggest problem in this country in education as well, is when I moved here to Philadelphia, I made all these great girlfriends, and it was just shocked at how many of my girlfriends either were in a relationship with a man who was locked up, or were in a relationship with a man who